My dear friends, I'm truly looking forward to this session with the Un Academy. I've known Un Academy for a number of years by now, when they were setting up and they had a vision. And I never knew how far they'd come. These youngsters have done amazingly well, made a great contribution. They're living their own vision. This is one group I know has the potential and the vision to make it to the top of the world. I have my best wishes and prayers for the Un Academy. I'm so happy. I'm sure you're all benefiting from what Un Academy gives you, and that it all lies in your hands, how much you add to it. Now today, I'm here to actually add to your thinking. I do know that you work closely and gain a lot from what Un Academy teaches you. And they gave me a subject of my choice. What UPSC may not, and I chose this subject for you, what UPSC may not be able to test aspirants adequately on. Because this is my experience. This is my experience that we say that we got the best. Somebody selected the best. But do we really have the best? Do they perform the best? Do they give their best? And do they sustain, if they come with coming the best, do they sustain the best? So in what way I feel that UPSC may not be able to test aspirants on, and I have some ideas for you. Let me go to my next slide. Now, this is a question which I have for you. All UPSC aspirants do the following. And I know you do the following, you're going to agree with me. You all do, you volunteer for the exam, don't you? Nobody tells you. You choose. You choose to become a UPSC aspirant. And then the best part is that once you qualify the whole thing and work hard and do your writing and pass the examination, you give right answers in the interview. When you pass the prelims and you pass the writing, you get very good answers in the interview. I know that. I've heard many of you, when I asked them many times, "Acha, is question ka kya jawab diya?" You give all the right answers. You are asked for, "Will you stay honest?" It's a challenge for you. You say, "Of course, sir. Of course, sir. Ma'am, we have to fight back. India needs every young man. And integrity is so critical." And then you give all the right. What will happen if you are forced to do something? You give the right answers. You never say, "I'll give up." You always say, "I'll not give up. I'll not give in. I'll stand up to it." So you give the right answers, don't you? You spend your own money in preparing for it. You spend your own money, parents' money, bank money, but you spend your own money. And the best part is you stay healthy. You stay physically fit, because when you want to go for the interview or the stamina for the examination, you stay very healthy, you stay fit. And then you also work very rigid. You have very planned work habit. And the best part is, as I said, you research yourself. Nobody tells you to research. The Un Academy guides you. The others guide you. The Google guides you. And others guide you. But you are the researcher. You search yourself. You learn from all directions. You are not at that time saying, "Oh, he's too junior, he's a young teacher, or he's a young student, I'm older than him." You learn from all directions. Immaterial of the age group, you are willing to learn from it. You learn even from school books, because school has the basic general knowledge. So you learn from all directions. And you seek support systems, don't you? You need your parents' help, you need your friends' help. You seek support from all directions. And you innovate. You're all the time creating your own answers and your own theorems and your own plans and your own essays. You are assembling your own knowledge material. You're creating your own theory. So you innovate. You constantly innovate because you want to score better. And then the best part is you stay out of zone. You stay out of comfort zone. When I was studying for exam in the hostel, I would sit in the hostel because I would go to sleep, the fan would put me to sleep, or the cooler, those times desert coolers, would put you to sleep. I would take my books out, go out in the lawns, sit under a tree. I don't care whether the mosquito bites me or not, but I sat under a tree. to learn so that I don't go to sleep, I don't doze off because I had to prepare and I got out of my comfort zones. You all get out of comfort zones, you leave homes, you travel elsewhere, apartment sharing, you spend a lot of money, you travel long distances, your parents come and help you out and to help you to study like my mother also did. So why does we all look for support systems? And then we remain curious. We are always curious to learn more and more. All right. Now, this is what I thought, that this is what you do. All aspirants do the following. I'm taking you to the trap. Try and understand why I'm taking you, because this is what is important. Now, let me go to the next thinking, which I have. Now that you've qualified, what happens? You qualified, your hard work paid off, and you are the very few out of thousands and thousands, you qualified. You qualified the written, you qualified the interview, and you qualified, right? And you got the appointment letter, and you're in cloud nine. You are so thrilled. You go to all your temples to say, thank you, God. You go to all places, wherever you wish you went, or you go on pilgrimages. You go back to your elders, say, thank you. It's because you go back to your teachers, you go and say, thank you. You are grateful. You don't forget that. You go back and thank. You send out letters, you sound, and you're in cloud nine and you celebrate. You celebrate. And then what you do, you get opportunities. Now you're getting trained. Now that you're qualified, you've reported for a state, a particular service, whatever service you get, you are now into practical service called state attachment. You're given a cadre and you cut, or you go to an academy. What happens? You get trained. You get trained in all respects. You are riding, you are yoga, you are into law classes, you are into management classes, you are into psychology, you are into information technology. You are getting holistically trained. And therefore, you get opportunities to learn. Now, from the training academic, which is you are into suit boot, you are into cloth tie, you are in a black bandgala, you are in dinner suits, you are into a dining table. You're all very, very careful with what you do, because now your inter-say seniority is dependent on the way you take the exam in the training academy. And training academy looks at teaches you manners, you raise your hands to speak, you prepare, you take your exams, etc. So now you're qualifying for inter-say seniority. But service by now, you have known, so you are into bunches, you are making friends, you are getting to know each other. So once you qualify the UPSC, what happens? You are getting trained, you are networking, you are understanding the laws, the regulations, the rules, etc., etc. So you're doing field work, etc. Now I'm taking you to the field. Like for instance, a probationer has come and got posted to Union Territory Cadre, which is like he comes to Pondicherry, where I am. What does he do? He gets opportunities to learn. He gets opportunities to see. He gets opportunities to observe the way the collector works, the way the SDM works, the way the SSP works, the way the education secretary works. So he is now getting attached to various officers to see. He also interns with Raj Rivas and come see how the way we work. So he gets opportunities to learn, to see and observe. And the best part is that while he's not contributing yet, he's only learning, he's getting a great salary, he's getting a full-fledged salary. It doesn't distinguish between probationer and confirmed. He gets his class one, grade A, grade B, whatever. He gets your full salary, so you get your salary check. And then you get not only yours, you are medically taken care of, your tours, even your family is now covered. Even your spouse, your family, they're all covered. So your family now, you are into a secure assignment. It's like, see now, you qualified and now you've come for training and you are seeing you're qualifying and preparing. So once you're posted, I want you to look into the mirror. Once you're posted, please look into the mirror. You see, you were grateful, you were non-hierarchical, you were well-mannered, you were saying the right things, you were into your value, otherwise you would have not made it to the interview. I want you to look into the mirror. What happens? What happens? Now the change begins. Friends, now the change begins. You've been tested on your memory. You've been tested in your analytical ability. You've been tested on your communication skill, to what limited way. You've been tested on your thoughts as you expressed in your essays. So, after all, general knowledge is memory. You could connect the two and that was memory. But somewhere you've been given an analysis, you passed the test. And you passed a small interview test, which tested your ethics a bit here and there. But what happens then, once you're posted? Your research declines. I've seen it. Your research declines. Very soon. Not long. Very soon. Now, exceptions are everywhere. I'm not generalizing. But I'm only telling you what I've seen. Not on Pondicherry, but across the board. That's why I said, for my 40 years of experience, I see. I saw it with my batchmates. I saw it with youngsters. I saw. The research declines. Now you feel research is not your need. It's a junior's kaam. A junior ka kaam. Mera nahi. Your research declines. You stop researching. Exceptions are there and I know my exceptions. Hard work declines. Now you say 9 o'clock and now it's 5 o'clock. It's 6 o'clock. It's time to go. And I switch off my phone after 6 o'clock because this is my time. Did you do this when you were sitting for the UPSC? You were 24/7 because you wanted to get selected. You wanted to be appointed. But now you are saying, hey, fine. Now it's 5 o'clock. How can anybody call me after 6? It's my time. And how can somebody call me on a Saturday and a Sunday? It's my time. And then you, when you were preparing, you neither had a Saturday nor had a Sunday. You wanted to prepare. You wanted to qualify. Your curiosity and keenness to learn declines. Why should you? I'll ask for a report. If there is a need to go on site to see, you say, no, I can ask for a report. It's much easier. And now I go by the report. So you go by reports. Your curiosity and keenness to learn declines. Then your willingness to learn by experience declines. Your reading of rules and laws declines because now there's no test to pass. Priorities alter, starts to swing more towards me and myself. Me, myself and my family. I've seen this happen. And then office comfort now becomes more than the field. Fear? Why can't I? Sir, my shoes will get... How can I go, sir? Outside is a issue. It's not clean. It's dirty. And people jump at me. They'll all pounce at me. So what happens is you become office comfort more than the field. Field is for the constabulary. Field is for the C category. Field is for my juniors. Not me. Field is not for me. Then not me. I have to get a report. Then earlier you were willing to take support from anybody. You were willing to learn even from school books. Now you say, this is not my job. It's their job. So they become office comfort more than the field. Then you become more person oriented than public oriented. You shut your door. Who are you? Put your appointment. No appointment. How can you ring me up at my time? Don't you think it's a lieutenant governor's office? How can you ring me up at lieutenant governor at my time? How can you WhatsApp me? Don't you know I'm a DGP? Don't you know I'm a secretary and I'm a joint secretary and I'm a special secretary and I'm a deputy secretary and I'm a collector? How can you call me up just like that? How can you come? Don't you see there's no appointment time? So there is no comfort zone. You're more in the comfort zone than the field. Then they become more person and public oriented. Public, come to some jagah jao na, udhar jao. Idhar kya kar rahe ho? Udhar jao. I'm sure whatever I'm saying, you have all gone through it as ordinary citizens. Or some of you who joined the UPSC already, then you are the gifted. But those who yet to, you may do it, you may not do it. I don't know that. But I'm sure you have gone through this when you were approaching seniors for help. Then you are less accessible and you don't tour enough. You're touring, you tour, you go by car, AC car, and you come back, You come back quickly. So what happens is that you don't stay back because there's no clean toilet, there's no clean water, and people are not healthy. So you don't want to stay back. How can you stay back in a Jugi Jompri area? How can you? And there's no guest house there. So there is no place to stay. So you don't tour enough. You stay, don't, and if you tour, you don't stay there. You start nursing your own nest. You become very family centric. You need a quickly everything for your house, and you need to gather more money and resources and network to get your so-and-so married, right? So-and-so married. So, or find a, build a house quickly. So, and you are very used to evening luxuries. You want your evening luxury. You want a dinner out. So-and-so, if you're in secretary hospitality, secretary tourism, how can every five-star house hotel not invite you daily? And then you don't, you're afraid to speak out. When you are called by a chief secretary or you called by the senior, you're afraid. How can I tell him? You don't even write the right thing on the note. You don't quote the law. You just say four orders. You just say four orders. What do you mean? Where is your application? If you were to be tested, would you not have applied your mind and written the rules and regulations, attached the right things on the file to say reference page such and such, please see, this is the law, this is the rule. And now, this is my view, sir, as a deputy secretary or an undersecretary or a desk officer or a secretary. This is my view. For orders, may like to order, let the person order, but you write what you need to write. But rather than say, you say for orders, you don't write what your views are. And you facilitate irregularities. You sometimes conspire into irregularities, or you say, okay, I can facilitate an irregularity. I can amend the law like this. I can choose a rule like this, sir, to meet your rule. I can amend the, tweak it a little so that I can accommodate you. You didn't do that for UPSC, for example. Then you stay put in and you stay away from difficult circumstances. That's not my job. How can I work this? This is my job of the Jew. You stay away. You stay in a very sanitized place. And you start lobbying for transfers and postings already because you're looking for the next assignment. You see which minister is more powerful, which person is more powerful, which a rich man is more powerful. So what happens? You start lobbying for. See, this is a list which is indicative. It's not exhaustive. It's not exhaustive. I have just thought it from the top of the head. As I said, you have very good people who live up to all these also, who measure up also. And that's why the country is somewhere safe. Country is safe because of them today. Those who stand up to courage, stand up to righteousness, stand up to what they said in the interview. I asked, now I'll tell you, I was at the academy lecture once, and a probationer got up from that audience and said, Madam, what do we do when we are told to do something irregular, which is not regular, and how do we do it? I said, very good. I said, were you asked this kind of question in the interview? That what happens if you are asked to do something irregular, and what would you do? I said, what would you have said? He said, he or she said, I would do what I think is right, and I would place the matters before the honorable next senior, and then ask the senior to take responsibility. So I said, then you answer your own question. The point is, we forget what we answered to get the job. We forget what we answered to get the UPSC appointment. And you think your job is over, appointment done. Now I'm a daughter-in-law or a son-in-law of the government. I may do what you want, what I may write or not. I am now forever. Unless I've caught red-handed for something wrong, I'm here forever till I breathe my last, because I also will get my pension. Now, what happens when we do all this, my friends? What happens? The municipalities are dirty because the municipal commissioners don't walk the streets. They're not field-oriented. They don't want to dirty their feet. They don't walk. They go for a walk. They'll go for a gym, but they'll not walk. They'll not walk the streets. What if municipal commissioners walk the streets? What if collectors walk the streets? What if superintendents of police patrol the roads? What if what if all those who are linked with the field work walk the talk? Walk the talk. Instead of, they can go for tennis every evening, they can go golf, they'll not walk the parks, they'll not walk the streets, they'll not visit the places. It's not that they don't. I'm not saying they, these individuals who've changed. So municipalities are dirty. They're terribly dirty. You think that if the municipal commissioner was daily walking and driving through the streets, the municipalities would be dirty? No way. Everybody will be on the job early and they would clean up, they act. So municipalities won't be dirty. ponds and lakes you think would be dirty? If the collectors would be working with the panchayats, the SHGs, and the mandregas, and the rural communities, and all of them, would you think the panchayat, and they would look at all, and they would really be the coordinators? You think it would be dirty? No way. The collectors would collect, coordinate, bring everybody together on a regular basis, and have a sabha around the pond, around the lake, have festivals, do tree plantations. They would be dirty? No way. Oh, you might just say they won't have money. They didn't have money. No. There are enough of NGOs. There are enough of corporate social responsibilities everywhere today. They are waiting to support you, provided you ask, but not take anything. Ask in kind, not in money. You say you adopt the pond. You take the machinery to the spot and you do it. By the way, we did this in Puducherry, and that's how we made Puducherry water rich, by in kind donation, not in cash. No touching money. You hire a machine, we give you the irrigation canal, you use the machine to desilt, and you pay the contractor. And the contractor will not fleece you or pickpocket you. So we made sure that the money is right. We did it. Pondicherry became water rich 2 years ago by CSR support, friends. Question is, ponds and lakes will not be choked. You will be water rich because rainwater will go in there. Arrests will never be selective. Arrests will never be selective because you're on the growth, and if the SP is around and you say, hey, galat FIR likhi, aap hai, aap ne galat giraftari ki, you'll observe human rights, you go by the law and you'll go by the rules. Teachers in school, supposing is an education secretary, will go to the schools in the morning. Hello children, how are you doing? Here I am. I'll go at the end of the table to say how's the class being taught. You think any teacher will not be punctual? All the class teachers would be there. So education secretaries, so teachers will no more be absent. So what I'm saying is, and your personal growth, you went to the spiritual places, but you forgot the nature. You forgot the Almighty. You forgot your parents sometimes. You forgot your teachers. You forgot all those who made it happen. Your personal growth comes to a standstill. Your spiritual growth. Now, let's see to the next one. What happened? So once you're posted, I wanted to show you the mirror. I'm only giving you part of the mirror. Part of the mirror. I want you to have a mirror all the time. Mirror of your own before the UPSC, and then during the UPSC, and then immediately after the UPSC. And then you keep the mirror. And then keep the mirror, ask the mirror what it is. Now, due to which, look at this. Due to which, India spends 10 point, do I have next slide? Yes, yeah. India spends 10.18 trillion rupees, which is 8.15% of nation's GDP, and has 2.15 crores of government employees. Imagine if all these 215 crore government employees would walk the streets, go to the field, do their own research, work with their team members, look at the welfare of the staff. The DGP looks after the welfare. DGP stands up and speaks up for the welfare of his staff and never allows wrong transfer and posting. You think that if the leader does, and then he's ready to move. Say, I'm ready to move, but I will stand up for only what is right. What's the problem? India is a very beautiful country. You'll move only within your own cadre. Just be ready to move. India spends, poor country, 10.18 trillion, 8.15% of the nation's GDP is spent on these government employees. This is the cost we are paying for our public service purpose. So friends, I would say, change is the law. Change is the law. Wherever you are, I didn't have glasses when I started the service. I have glasses today. Change is the law. We will keep growing out wherever we are. We start at the age of 20, 21, 23, depending on the age at which you qualify. No posting is permanent. Change is the law. No posting, no chair. Don't hang on to the chair. Change chair doesn't belong to you. It is all temporary. The only thing you have is growth. But that's optional. So change is the law. Chairs will keep changing. Postings will keep changing. You'll start growing. You'll have promotions. You'll have new designations. You'll have new offices. You'll have new colleagues. You'll have new charges, changes the law. You'll have no series, you'll have new geography, you'll have new areas. But that's the law. So what are you hanging on to? It doesn't belong to you. The position doesn't belong to you. It's temporary. It's transient. What belongs to you is growth. Growth to the chair and growth to yourself. That, I think, gets missing. We forget this chair is permanent. We feel, oh, growth kya hai? Woh toh apne aap chalti rahegi. Ye toh mantriyon ka kaam. Ministers will make sure the policies and growth will happen. But growth is in your hands. You are the decision makers. You are the decision makers. You are the policy makers. You are advisors. You are the implementers. You are the process givers. You are from the Union Public Service Commission. UPSC means leadership. UPSC means management. UPSC means strategy. UPSC means planning. UPSC means budget growth. UPSC means thinking, innovation, growth. So choose. That's what I'm saying. Choose wisely. That's why I wanted to show you, wanted to take you to this. That choose wisely, because we're all suffering. What do I have in the end? No, not this. So I wanted to tell you, the UPSC tests, you are on intelligent quotient, but doesn't test you. So what does, that's why my title was, that UPSC, what does UPSC never test you? I can go back to my first slide, right? This is what I said. So what UPSC may not be able to test aspirants is all these issues. You are not tested on these. So this is what I said once you posted. So you are not tested on these. Now I have a few questions before me, that what you are not tested on lies entirely in your hands. And that is where we say we select the best. If I may wind up this with an acronym I've created for you, is this. I want to give you a word called grasp. G for get to know. Wherever you are, keep getting to know. G for grasp. G for first word, keep getting to know. When I'm saying that, choose wisely. Change is the law. Growth is optional. See, growth. G for growth. Keep growing. Keep. And how will you grow if you don't get to know? Find ways to get to know more, research more, see more, feel more, listen more, meet more, live more. All right? R for reflection. That's called personal audit. Ask for your own personal audit. I do that regularly. It's a personal audit of the day. You must have a personal audit of the day, my friends. Okay? So personal audit is very important. How am I remembering what I said then? Am I living up to that? Am I living up to what gave me this amazing service, the country's best service, the top service through the UPSC? Am I living up to that? Reflect. A is accept. Certain limitations will be there. There are accept limitations, or limit of budget, limit of policy, limit of the law. There are limitations. There are boundaries. They call boundaries. So within boundaries, there will be limitations. But those limitations are the legal limitations, the financial limitations, and sometimes behavioral limitations. They will be, but that's your training and experience will teach you. S for sensitive. Remain sensitive. Just as you were sensitive to be selected, you wanted your orders passed, you were very keen to know your results, and you were anxious as somebody. So you were sensitive for good responses. And P is practice. So grasp, I want to give you the word grasp. One is G, get to know, is growth. R, reflect. A, accept. S, sensitive. P, practice. I want to give you one more cue. When you posted, it's a concept called T. T-E-A. T-E-A. Please make a note. T-E-A. T is for trust. Remain trustworthy. You should be predicted that if a file has come to you, people know she or he will not do injustice. He or she will apply the law, will not spare anybody, or be compassionate and sensitive depending on bona fide or mala fide. Be predictive. Build trusting. Be trustee. T-E is empower people. Empower. Train people. Empower. Just as you want to be trained and empowered, so should you pass this on to others. So A, be trustworthy. Just as you want a senior to be trustworthy, you remain trustworthy yourself. Second is empowerment. How do you remain empowered? How do you empower others? Delegate. But that doesn't mean you lose control. You watch. You groom. It's grooming, but it's empowering. A for accountability. If you've done, if something by your decision, your giving, something gone wrong, you are going to take accountability. You will take the responsibility. Say, I told my junior to do this. Therefore, if my junior made a bona fide mistake, not malafide, then sir, I am responsible. Please deal with me, not with him. Friends, the T concept for leadership, this is a leadership concept. The grasp is for your mirror. So grasp is when you look into the mirror, that you look at the growth, get to know growth, reflect, accept, sensitive and practice. But T is when you become a leader, you get positioned, then be trustworthy. Keep empowering and get empowered as you wish. Every senior will not empower you, but that doesn't mean you don't empower others. So you empower. Every senior, you will not find accountability. I've had situations of where my seniors told me, jo tumne kiya kiya, apne aap bhukto, you bear the consequences. I said, sir, I will. But that didn't mean I passed it on to say, no, I am now my senior is not supporting me. I'm not supporting you also. You do what you want. No, the buck stopped here. The buck stops with you. So the T concept, which I thought I'll share with you. The point here is now let's take the questions. Number one, where are my questions? Hey, what are the key challenges posed before UPSC aspirants? Answers to which there should be. But the key challenge is exactly what I told you. They'll be asking you. So you are preparing for the, you are, if those of you who are listeners are preparing for the UPSC, be prepared. How is best? How does government deal with COVID? What is an SOP? Why is an SOP important? And number two, all key challenges would be, supposing you left on your own and there's nobody else with you, how will you deal with the challenge? Will you run away? You said, no, sir, I will spend my night there. I'll dig and I'll ask for help, but I'll not give up, sir. The key challenges posed will be your inner nature. You will be challenged, asked about the software, but then you might artificially say the answer. I think answer authentically. These are your key challenges. The second question is, will it be possible for aspirants to be politically neutral once appointed? Yes. If you just choose not to align yourself with anybody, you are equal to all. You're not a politician. You're an administrator. But if the politician is right, you will accept that. If the politician is legally wrong, you will not accept that. But that doesn't mean you get politically inclined or aligned. No. You can be politically neutral. You are justice neutral. You are law neutral. You are decision neutral. You are not politically neutral. You are administratively neutral. But if the politician is giving you good advice, it's excellent. That's what they are supposed to be doing. But if he is giving you to twist around, then you can say the answer would be, will it be possible? Yes. Be politically neutral. You can show the law. We have many officers. We have political neutral officers around the country. We have many, many in Pondicherry as well. One of them is our own chief secretary, Ashwini Kumar himself. He's a politically neutral person. It's so easy to work with him because he's not inclined. He's not inclined with anybody. He looks at the law and he looks at the rule and he applies it and he writes it on the file. That's it. And it makes my life very easy because I can trust him. See, it's a trusting relationship. I trust him because I know he'll be politically neutral. And therefore, I know he's not taking sides. But I apply my mind and I also give a politically neutral, which is applicable to the law, being assisted by my OSD, Mr. Neeti Das, totally politically neutral. So we are able to give a politically neutral stance to the administration of Puducherry. We can be. Many police, many administrative officers are also there, but some of them are shaky. If we do that, what happens? Naraaz ho jayenge, gusse ho jayenge, ACR mein likh denge. So, well, remember, it's not a non-risk job. It's a risk. So if you're politically aligned, you also run a risk. Remember that. Remember that, because you'll be crucified by the other. So decision making is not ordinary. But it's your maturity, how you place matters and slip out of it. But being politically aligned is equally risky than being politically neutral, both risky. But you have to choose the risk. As I said, you have to choose growth is optional. So once appointed, I said, third, is Swachh Bharat, Green India, water rich, Atmanirbhar Bharat possible? And by whom? By the public servants. Politicians come after. It's the collectors. It is the collector. The area SDOs, area SDPOs. They are the ones working with panchayats, working with RAWs, working with NGOs, working with volunteers, working with non-profit, working with CSRs. I guarantee you, without much cost, Green India is possible. You can involve all schools in Greening India. You can involve CSRs in Water Rich. You can Atmanirbhar as policy maker. You can constantly say what is not Indian. How can we make the local vocal? If you are in the field all the time and seeing things, you can Swachh Bharat, Green Bharat, Water Rich, Atmanirbhar is possible. Of course, you need money. And money is coming, scheme. But you are the scheme's implementer. So when it comes to crores of rupees, you are the implementer. You have to make sure it is honestly delivered. The process is honestly delivered. It's in your hands. So these are my three questions. Do we have more?
Yes.
Oh, good. Fourth question. Is effective rule of law enforcement possible and by whom? It's possible. When the leadership decides, the police headquarters decide the rule of law, period. Police headquarters clearly says a message, no false FIR, no false arrest, apply the Gunda Act on the Gundas, whoever it is, history sheets be made, preventive sections of law be done, effective patrolling be done, I'm on the ground with you every day, I'll work through citizen wardens, traffic wardens, and I will have cameras watching. It's possible, friends. Effective rule of law enforcement lies as in the policy domain of the police headquarters. Not one person, police headquarters, which has the DGP, the additional DGPs, the police other commissioners. It's the PHQ policy. What is the PHQ policy? PHQ policy would be the rule of law and fearlessly done. Once the law is clear and no deviations made, no exceptions to the rule, everybody will fall in line. Everybody will fall in line. But if you pick and choose, then you will also be picked and chosen. You pick and choose, you will also be picked and chosen. All your life you'll say, kisne pick kiya, kisne choose kiya. You will lose your sense of freedom. So let's look at the next question. Can you give us a takeaway which would be helpful for us as aspirants? Well, I've given you the takeaway grasp. I think the grasp is get to know, reflect, accept, sensitive and practice. And I've also given you the takeaway T concept. Trusting, empowering, and accountability. I've already given you this. If you take it or leave it. Take it or leave it. But if you take it today, I think the Unacademy would have made a stellar contribution to giving a new branch, a new generation of UPSC candidates serving, to be coming or serving or under training or elsewhere. Now, what is the last one, I hope, are there more? What is a holistic approach while preparing for UPSC? I think that brings me to the crux. The crux is we prepare physical health-wise. We go intellectually, memory-wise. We go intellectually. We work on our intellect. We memorize. We research. It's all intelligence and memory. And more than intelligence, it's memory. It's more memory. That's why most of you forget after that because you just finished and now you don't want to read. I'll tell you one example now. I told you, I will. A batch of probationers came calling on me in Pondicherry. A very bright branch. Some of them were professionals, engineers, doctors also, management MBAs today. And some of them were very, it's across the board, professionals on many other fields as well. But then I asked them about a particular news and I said, do you read editorials in the newspapers? I asked these probationers. I said, do you read editorials in the newspapers? They all looked at each other. Probably just one or two raised their hands, rest looked at each other. They had stopped reading editorials in the newspapers. But when you were preparing for the UPSC, you were reading editorials. You were marking editorials. You were memorizing languages. You were keeping your files and documents and notes. What happened now? You have stopped reading and acquiring knowledge. But before that, along with that, you worked on IQ. You worked on the mind, the body. All right, you worked on the mind, you worked on IQ. Where's your emotional quotient? Who worked on your emotional quotient? You get angry. You flare up. You mean to say, could this have been judged by the interview board? Because they never provoked you. You were never provoked. Some of them are terribly angry people. You throw files. Many officers are known to be throwing files. Where did they get this anger from? How could they be judged by the UPSC? Which means your emotional quotient is not tested. You've only been tested on IQ. You've not been tested on your EQ. And EQ comes by SQ, spiritual quotient. These two are interlinked. This is linked with your inner software. You've only got the external hardware tested and a little portion of this brain which was keeping the memory bit. But rest of it is not tested by the UPSC. Your spiritual quotient is not being tested. You've not been offered a bribe, very interesting bribe, which assures you a wonderful home overseas and lets your child go overseas for a scholarship. You've not been tested. But the country is testing you and the country is suffering you. Country is suffering you. People suffer you when you do not have a SQ and your emotional quotient is constantly, and you think one day is this, your test is this, at work is your test every day. How you deal with your colleagues, how you deal with every file, how you deal with policy making, how you deal with your juniors, your seniors, your people at large, the environment, the crisis, the challenges, the adversity, the discomfort. That's tested every day. That's where your emotional quotient will be tested. You're being disturbed by your family calls you back, saying, kya liya, paaki hone to ghar bana liye, itna furniture. What have you brought for us? You don't get angry, you don't tell them, saying, wait on, I'm not like that. I have joined the UPSC to open, to fatten my bank account. I'm here to live, to serve and get lived very well. So don't you expect that from me? So my friends, your emotional quotient, and then your finally is the spiritual quotient, which to my mind very well given by Sadhguru or Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. Sadhguru calls it inner engineering. Sri Sri Ravi Shankar calls it art of living. There's an art of living and it's called an inner engineering. These are not their monopolies. The words are not their monopolies. These are their processes which they give you. But inner engineering is a daily affair. Art of living is the way we living our lives. So I would say inner engineering and art of living and our yoga and our way of life, the whole style of living. And we have today excellent trainers and teachers today available on the net. You can listen to their discourses every day. You can have a day plan to listen to them. You go to the net, there's such inspirational discourses which helps you audit yourself on a regular basis, which gives you the mental fitness, which gives you the mental nutrition every day. So if you nutrition yourself every morning, rather than suddenly getting up and running around, just take your time. Give yourself time. If you're a police officer, it doesn't matter. Find accordingly. Find the time, but keep calm and keep composed. That will not happen if you do not do inner engineering. If you do not learn the art of living, if you do not live a yogic way of life, which is eyes open. Yoga means you do not know the Vipassana. Vipassana is another form of meditation which makes you work with eyes open. That means you're constantly self-observing yourself. As you're hearing yourself, you're observing yourself, you're seeing yourself. Friends, country needs people who do their regular audit every day, who evolve every day, who grow every day. who live up to the expectations every day, and realizing India is not so rich. India is not so rich as to be saved. Let me go here. India is not so rich. India is not so rich to be spending 10.18 trillion rupees, putting nearly 19% of the GDP on this 2.15. If they were all inner engineered, then India would have been Atmanirbhar today. India would have been strongest today. India would have been the most honest economy today. And from you will also be MBAs who will go into the business community. So friends, I thought this is what I can contribute to you. I beg pardon of if I've hurt anybody. I've just said we got brilliant exceptions, both in the political field and we also have in the public administration. We have them, and it is on their shoulders the country still surviving and thriving. But if most of us would look into the mirror ourselves regularly, if you would every day, when you would go to every day in the mirror, ask yourself, did I live up to the expectations of what I said to my interview, which gave me this job, which gave me this service, which is rare, and miles of people would be standing to take your position today where you are, or you are preparing to get. You will be the rare one, that one who gets it, because you prepared well, you strategically studied, you researched well, but when you are interviewed, you are not tested yet on EQ yet enough, because there's nothing in no scheme in the world which totally tests you fully yet. We are not, this is in the realm of humanities, and humanities is an imperfect science. It's not science, chemistry, etc., where you can say every, it's not that kind of arithmetic. I'm a student of humanities, I know. It's an imperfect science. It's an evolving science all the time. Humanities is, that is why it's liberal arts. It's called liberal arts. So friends, I think when you get up in the morning, plan your, those of you who can plan the day, look through yourself, see, did you answer the call for which you stood? And when I told you that question of stopping to read, having read newspapers or being alert to editorials, reading the sacred space, reading speaking trees, reading cosmic time, whatever. These are wonderful things which come in the newspapers. Read them. Make your own library. Keep them stored with you. Read it. I do that. I wish to tell you, you might just say, madam, you're being theoretical. No, I do that. What I'm telling you, I do that religiously. Do my morning fitness religiously. I do my own thinking reflection religiously. I do my morning nutrition religiously. Unless I feed myself with good thoughts, my day doesn't get started. And then my day builds on that. I don't get tired during the day because I built it on energy. I built it on positivity. If we do that, then any challenges which come through files, individuals, otherwise environmentally, they have taken one thing at a time. So far, it's been an element of Lord's grace. This, I think, is my time to be saying bye-bye to you and to say, I wish you all very well. I wish to see in my lifetime a whole new cadre of UPSC candidates and officials who actually take India to become Atmanirbhar. Atmanirbhar in all respects, water, sanitation, cleanliness, greenery, economy, education, you can, information technology, you name it. And that will happen only through two, three things. One is art of living. Second is inner engineering. Third is vipassana, self-meditation. I'm not saying go for these. I'm saying these are words. These are words. You can make them verbs. It's up to you. But these are available. And I search for discourses on the YouTube every day. You've hit upon some wonderful ones. The Gita lessons all on the spiritual. Plenty, the Chinmaya missions, the Ramakrishna mission. I'm sorry if I'm not remembering those names. I have already read them. The autobiography of a yogi, living with the Himalayan masters. Go about reading them. Read these kinds of books on a regular basis. Make them your best friends. You are in the best profession once you come into the UPSC. Best profession. You have the whole country looking up to you, individually and collectively as a service. Therefore, the point here is, as I said, you have to do this. Change is the law. Growth is optional. Choose wisely, one day at a time. Thank you and Jai Hind. I want to thank the An Academy for having given me such wonderful, and the Hindu group. The Hindu group which has made it possible, and the An Academy, both of you, who invited me to speak my heart out. As I said, I've come it out for the love for it, because I love the next generation. I see a whole new hope in the new generation, where it will be intellectually, emotionally, and spiritually, emotionally at top of their quotients. God bless you.